Hello, welcome back to the Fish Locker. Today we're down at Seabourne Fish. Now, I'm going to have to start with a warning. This video is going to contain fish filleting and fish processing. So if you do not want to see those type of things, this video isn't going to be for you. For everybody else, I have tagged timestamps into the description of the video for each specific fish. So if you want to just see a cod, if you want to just see mackerel or plaice or bass, you can jump to exactly where in the video this is. Right now, we're going to go inside and we're going to see Rich.
Morning John, thanks for coming. I hope you enjoy what we're about to do this morning. Brief introduction, I'm Rich, I've worked for Dave here at Seabourne Fish for 10 years. I've only ever worked in the food industry all my life. I thoroughly and really enjoy working with fish and love learning new processes every day. On the note of you asking about filleting knife, 8-inch Victorinox Five Rocks, brilliant filleting knife for the job, nice and flexible and nice and cheap at about 16. So starting with the cord, like I say, it's already gutted for us. We're going to insert our fingers into the belly cavity, hold the fin back, and then we're going to go in here. And then we're going to go right up into the head, right up here. But up here, there's plenty of meat. Don't come across here, you lose so much of the fish. Now, for me personally, I like to tauten the fish up, come down the
now see there, you've bent it in like a moon shape, like a crescent.
Just to tighten it up, just to tighten that flesh up and define this ridge. So where the fin is, yeah, where the two fins are, we're coming down along the top of that, right the way to the tail. And for me, I go in across here, just down near the tail, come straight down and right out the other side. And then it's a case of just holding the fish.
So you've just, pulled the meat away, haven't you?
Just pulled the meat away from the bone, but you can see there's the bone, there's no meat left on that. And then it's in with a knife right up into the head. And again, as you start coming away and coming up towards the belly, there's the belly cavity. And now you can, with the top sort of inch of the knife, you can cut that right across. And from then, you go across the top of the belly bones, up the other side, and there's your fillet.
Perfect.
Now, for us here, we're obviously always priding ourselves on giving good quality, so we trim out anything that's a problem, and that is a beautiful fillet of cod. So we've just done that side. We'll turn him over and do the other side. Again, very straightforward. Fin back out the way. Knife in around the fin. Cut up. And then again, up into the head. Just like that. And again, bend the fish slightly to tighten it. And your knife is going to come in along above this fin. So we can start down at the tail. And try and use all the knife. Get a nice sweeping motion straight up through the fish. A lot of people tend to go in little small strokes. You tend to end up with a jaggedy fillet.
I was just going to say that you try and do it in like one long motion.
If you can do it in one long motion like that, you will find that your fillet will be very, very smooth and pristine. So again, following on from what we did on the other side, we're coming down round about the anal fin, across the backbone, right through, and then straight down to the tail. And from there, we come back up to the belly cavity. Quick whip through the belly bones with a sort of top inch and a half of the knife. Releases it. And then it's just a case of straight down, straight over, and straight out. And that's your fillet release.
Isn't that not a scratch on that now?
No. I mean, what's left on there isn't really worth talking about.
No.
One thing I would say, if you've got cod, white fish like this, and you enjoy cooking, then keep hold of this and make yourself a bit of fish stock. You know. So we've got the two fillets there, finished, and they're perfectly good as they are. And they would go on the counter, or you would have had them at home yourself. The next thing that I would be inclined to do, if you don't want them, is to pin bone them. So there's two ways of pin boning, the easy way and the bit more fiddly way. So we'll do the fiddly way first. So if you run your finger down here, you'll feel where the bones are.
I can see one, I can see a bone just in here.
Yeah. So starting from the top.
Is that just a pair of tweezers you've got there?
This is a pair of fish pliers.
I mean, if someone hasn't got those at home, what could they use?
someone hasn't got them at home, just use a normal pair of needle nose pliers. These are available about £2.50 on the internet. We'll use these ones, we'll use the cheaper ones. So have the fish so that the bones are facing you. You will find that it'll be easier to pull them out because you're pulling towards yourself rather than away from yourself. It's just a case of running down. Again, you'll feel with your fingers where they are. So we've pin boned that one with the conventional pliers, and there's no bones there.
Three mile here.
All these ones here. That we've lost no meat at all from the fish. There is another way of boning if you haven't got pliers. It's what we call V-boning. You do lose a little bit of the flesh of the fish, but basically you'll find the line of bones running down here, and you're going to cut your knife in gently to there. Back to where they sort of finish, and then come up the side of the loin. And then nick that out of there.
Right, see, that's millimetres thick though, you haven't really lost that there, have you?
But there's no bones there at all. There's nothing there to worry about. There's no bones from sort of where the belly cavity ends going down through the tail either. So for young children wanting to eat cod or anything, you know, families being worried about bones, that's, you know, an acceptable way to do it.
Perfect.
So after pin boning, I mean, the skin on cod is perfectly edible, and, you know, cooking with the skin on definitely retains the moisture of the fish. It doesn't dry it out. But you can, if you don't like the skin, skin them no problem. So starting at the tail end, you just nick in. And once you've got the little tag there that you can grab hold of, your knife, keeping the skin tight and just working your way down. This is where the flexible knife really comes into its own, because you can just
down like that. The angle that you were running at there, it was quite a shallow angle, wasn't it?
Yes. Yeah, sort of. We're coming down the fish like this, at this sort of angle. For me, it's keeping it nice and tight. I don't want anything left on this skin. For custom, you know, this, at the end of the day, that's what you want to be eating. You know, you don't want to be leaving anything on this fish. So now we'll move on to a flatfish. Flatfish, in principle, the filleting method is the same for all flatfish, whether it be a plaice, a lemon sole, a turbot, a brill, a dab, a flounder. They're all very similar. And the filleting wise, again, it's a similar process across the board for all those fish. So what we'll do is we'll start with a plaice. And I like to start with the flat side on the board.
And these have been gutted?
These have been gutted. Again, this comes from Newland Market, and these come gutted. So they're gutted on the boat, put into the ice hold, and then sold on Newland Market. So filleting wise, you've got a kind of head start because there's already a cut been put in. Again, it's removed, hold the fin back by the head, and come right up. Come up right around here, right around the sort of cheek of the fish. Don't cut across there because you're losing all this meat. And there's a nice thick piece of meat here. So once we've done that little cut, we're going to put the top couple of inches in to the fish, and then we're going to work down here. Now, luckily enough, with flatfish, the fins, they dictate kind of where you're going to go. And as long as you go across there and come down, you'll feel your knife will hit the actual structure of the vertebrae and the bones coming off the vertebrae, and your knife will just guide down slowly and gently along the fin line. And once you've done that, it's just a case of using the whole knife, going gently, and you'll feel the vertebrae, which your knife will hit here. You'll feel it hit the vertebrae, and then you can come back up the fish in one smooth movement. Hear my knife there going across the vertebrae. That's the sign that you've left no meat. And then it's a case of again going across the top of the backbone vertebrae, straight through, and we should come out the other side straight down.
When you went in with that first cut, you could see where you came in and you run along the top of these bones here.
That's correct. Yeah. So you're coming in here, and if you dig too deep, you'll hit the bones or you'll go in underneath. But if you go in gently and then push the knife, if you feel resistance, you know you've not gone into the underside. You know that those bones are stopping that knife. And that's the time to put a little bit of pressure on and just gradually slide your knife down. Coming down across in one nice smooth movement. So the next process, once you've got that, is hold the fillet back out the way, come across the backbone with the top couple of inches of the knife into the belly cavity, and again, similar to with the cod where we just cut through the belly bones, it releases. Once it's released, everything becomes so much easier. Here you can see we've got some roe, and Plaice are in, you know, the roes are good at the moment. If you like the roe, then great. The thing to do with it is to split it across there, come right down through, and again you're coming across these bones and coming right out and down
again in long
one. The more smoother the motion and the less cuts you can do, the better finished product you're going to get. Understandably, you know, if you're new to filleting, you're going to be going tentatively, I understand that. But the less cuts and the more smoother the action that you can do when you're coming across this fish, the better the finished product. So once you've done this side, you've got another side to do, which can become a little bit trickier because he's not so flat to the board. But hold the fin back, and there's no cut in this side because they only gut from the top side. But here you've got the cheek of the fish, and you're going to run in there with your knife, come around and cut him like that. So you're just repeating the process of what you did on the other side, going into the belly cavity. And again, if you find that the knife is pushing through, then you've got, and you're on the board, then you've gone too far. You need to come above. I don't know whether we can get it in. I'd cut that like that.
You could, for sure.
So you're going basically in here and going down. And once you get in there and you're keeping that knife nice and flexible, nice and bent, if you're finding it's jaggedy and it's catching on something, just take the pressure off the knife and just lift the tip. Just lift the tip of the knife and come down and out the tail. Along, again across the backbone, straight down to the tail. And from the tail, back up again to the belly cavity, straight through, release. Then coming down across there, and there's your Plaice all filleted. This bit of row you can keep if you like that sort of thing.
Yep.
And keep that for later. If you'd like the row removed, it's quite simply a case of sort of knocking it out of the way. One thing I would recommend is that we've got a few bones here, and this bit of belly can, to some people, taste bitter. To me personally, this is bitter, and it's more bitter on the black side, which I'll show you in a second. But if you come in, take those top few bones away, trim the frill, and there's your finished fillet. Perfect for frying, grilling, steaming, whatever takes your fancy. So again, we've got now the top fillet, which is a thicker fillet, and we've removed the roe, and you've got these few bones here and this bit of black belly sinew. Again, it's not very nice to eat, and as fishmongers here at Seabourne Fish, we do like to remove it for the customer so that they don't, you know, have to eat it. But
you eat it with your eyes as well, don't you?
You do, yeah, that's correct. And having these bones here, it's quite nasty. There's some real nasty sharp bones. We've done one process of going in and taking the bones away with the white side. Another quicker way of doing it is just to run along the top and cut across there, and all this really is bone, and this little bit of black stuff here is the belly sort of lining, which is again quite bitter to eat, to taste. And you're left there with another fillet that you can just pair up with that one, and you can do what you want.
Beautiful.
And then you've got your roe. Really quick go.
No, that's it, perfect. I'm watching going through it at proper speed.
learn the method and the speed will come. That's what I would teach anyone. It's nothing.
You've got no need to rush, have you?
No, you haven't. I mean, us here, yeah, we're working to time and stuff like that, and people are waiting. So we are quite, and we're sort of practiced at doing it quick. So, a gurnard, what everyone will catch. Beautiful eating, lovely firm texture to them, great for stews. They've got a lovely sweet flavour to them, in my opinion. So, again, with filleting these, be slightly careful because they've got a few nasty little spikes on them, which will hurt you, and they do go through your glove. So again, and there's a nasty, can you see that spike there?
Yep.
So you want to be careful of that. But when it comes to filleting, it's quite a simple process with a gurnard, and you're just going to go in to the vertebrae, turn your knife, and as you come down that vertebrae, you'll feel it. You'll be going along the vertebrae and straight out the tail, and there's your fillet.
So you literally just went straight into the backbone and then along the backbone.
Straight in, which I'll turn him over and do him again. I probably did that a little bit quick. So straight down to the vertebrae, turn your knife, come straight along. Keeping the knife flat to the backbone, trim him away.
That was literally, that was straight down, then a 90, and then straight along.
Yep. Perfect. Now, with the gurnard, you've got a lot of bones in the belly, sharp knife, straight down. You don't want to be eating these anyway. There we go. With gurnard, you get worms. Now, all fish have worms. Yes, they're not very nice, but all fish have them, and you will see them from time to time. There isn't any in this one, unfortunately.
Unfortunately
for me to show you. Yeah. But I'll do another one quickly and hopefully we'll find one.
The thing with worms in fish, you're going to get them. It's a wild fish.
That's correct, yeah.
As long as you either cook them fully or freeze them fully, they're never going to be a problem, are they?
So again, we're going to cut down those belly bones. And these belly bones aren't worth eating. They're not worth keeping. And there we go. Let's see if we can find one in a belly cavity to show you. Nah. So there we've got a worm. So that is what a worm
just looks like, a little
tapeworm type
thing.
It
almost looks like a miniature Danish pastry. It's just literally.
That's a great way to describe it. So with those, you'll see them in, if they were in the fish, they will be in the flesh, and it would be just be a case of sticking the point of your knife in, and just go in, twist, and then flip him out. So you'd go in through the centre, flip him out, just like that, and he'd be on your knife.
Just because you've seen worms in a fish like that doesn't mean the fish is bad or anything.
Oh, no, not at all. It's just depending on where it's living. I mean, you know, these gurnards, they come from right at the bottom of the sea. They're living in the sand, the mud, and you know, that's where the worms are, unfortunately. There you go. Lovely fillets. Beautiful. Pan fry those. Grill them. Put them into a stew. Whatever you want, really.
Fantastic.
So we'll move on now to mackerel. Mackerel, realistically here, we get asked to fillet it, to butterfly it, or to leave them whole. Sometimes head off, sometimes head on, depending on what the customer requires. So I'll start off with the main one we get asked for, which is filleting. Again, very similar to the gurnard, which we've just done. We're holding back the fin, and we're gonna go in at an angle, down to the backbone, until you find the vertebrae, which you see the fins there, and then it's just a case of straight along, and away you go. And that's your filleted mackerel, prepared, ready to go, with the belly sinew removed, flipped over, same thing, straight down to the backbone. Keep hold of the fillet with your hand, come down, and again, remove this little bit of belly sinew, which has got some belly bones on it.
When you go in there to take them belly bones out, you're not cutting down into it, you're kind of scalloping out at
it. I'm basically shaving it out.
Yeah.
You don't want to waste any of the meat that's on there. All this is still edible. Personally for me, removing those few belly bones and that bit of belly sinew just gives you a better product. And that's something we pride ourselves on here, is giving a fine filleted product. Moving on, so we've got the gutted method. So it's basically in by the hole there, straight up, straight in, open your mouth, nick that away, pull that out, and that's your gutted mackerel ready to go. Give them a wash in the sink, and that we cook. You can cook that just like that. You know, roasted on the barbecue, whole. That's great. You know, on the beach in the summer, catch a few of them, put them on a barbecue like that. Best way to eat them.
Perfect.
Again, I've done a few fish now, and a nice starting. The edge is starting to go, so I'm going to give it a quick sharpen just to make sure that edge is super sharp for doing this method. So we're going to butterfly, and this is my method of butterflying. So you're going to hold the fin back, you're going to cut in, and you're coming down, and with the inch and a half of the knife, you're coming along the vertebrae.
But you're not going through the back.
Just to give you an idea of how far through the fish we're going and how deep into the fish we're going, we're coming along here. So if you imagine my knife being in that fish now, I'm coming in, down, and just coming along the vertebrae, but not coming out through the back of the fish. There's a reason for this, and you'll see it shortly. So there we go, we've come down. I've left no flesh on that. Then you're going to turn him over, hold the flat back, and again, straight down there, cutting behind. So once you get to here, find that vertebrae, come all the way down to about there. Now I like to leave the tails on. Some people don't, but personally for me, the tail on it is nice. Come along here. Once you get to this sort of stage, you can nick through there, and then literally that fillet that is now butterflied will pull away from the vertebrae of the fish, leaving you with a butterflied mackerel.
Yeah. So the reason why you don't go all the way through the back is to keep that central part.
To keep that central part
connected.
Yeah. So that there will have no bones running up the middle, but you'll have obviously the fins on the other side. There's nothing to worry about trimming in the belly, but in the belly, and you've got the tail there, which when you want to stick him on your barbecue, you can just lay him on skin side down.
Perfect.
I will run through another one because I know these are difficult. I'll try and go as slowly as I can. So we're in, feel the vertebrae. Once you feel that vertebrae, come along through the fish, bearing in mind not to go through the back, to about there. Once you open that up, you'll see that you've done what you need to do. You're sort of to the back of the fish, but not gone through the other side. You fold him over. Keep that fillet flat on your board, and it will stabilize the fish for yourself. In again, feel the vertebrae, straight down. Just caught there on the, that's where you've just caught him on the vertebrae, a bit too deep, Rich. Nick the back of the head.
So there's the three different ways. There's butterflied, filleted, with the belly bone scalped out, and just gutted.
Moving on, we're going to go on to bass. Now, our bass, we buy rod and line angler, which fishes out of Falmouth. He brings his catch to us on a daily basis, and it's with us within usually 4 hours. Ultra fresh. So good bass, a lot of people will want them filleted or whole. One thing we'll start off with is filleting, but one thing you don't want is the scales. Now when you're at home in the kitchen and not here in the fish shop, you're scaling the bass, scales are going everywhere. Your wife will not like all these scales around her kitchen because you'll be picking them up for a month of Sundays. So one thing worth doing is you've got a scaler, which we have here, or you can use the back of your knife. Drop them into a sink of water, and scale him under the water. The scales will stay within the water. At the same time, the fish is clean.
You do need to be careful of the spines on a bass when you're doing this, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, there's many a time I've put my finger into one of those, or one of those has gone into my finger and it hurts. So just hold on to the head, nice and firm, scale around the belly. So bass, again, same principle as all the other round fish we've done. You're going to go in, hold the fin back. The heads are quite tough, and around here you won't get your knife into that. So in here, right up, down, nick him out like that. And then again, it's a case of following down where the fin line is, and you'll go in. If you scaled him, the knife will go in nice and easy. And once you get to here, down across the backbone by the anal fin, in the, straight out through the tail. Coming back up. Now me personally, I like to make sure I avoid the belly bones and I go over the top of the belly bones with a bass. So here you'll see the belly bones are here running down. I will put my knife in, hold the fillet back out the way, and literally come down across there and come out.
So as you're cutting there with your right hand, are you pulling the meat away with your left hand at the same time?
Just literally teasing. I'm not pulling because we'll pull the flesh. I'm literally just guiding it away. So as my knife comes down over the belly bones, I'm guiding that fillet to fall into my hand.
The belly bones that you're on about?
The belly bones are these here, which you can see. This isn't...
That's a couple of millimetres thick. Yeah. That's not worth
money. I mean, this is all bone here. And underneath of that is the gut of the fish. So flipping him over. Again, holding the fish's fin back out of the way. You're going to go in, up into the head. Down, around, and then down, just like we did on the other side, above those fins, coming straight through, down to there, through and out. And then we're going to come up. Okay. Belly bones, nick across the top, tease that away, and then we're going down across the belly bones again. So we're losing.
You should be able to feel the knife running round on the back of the bone.
You can, yeah. You'll feel the bones, you'll feel the knife, which is hard to explain, but you'll feel the knife hitting those, and it'll roll over. And as long as you're turning the knife gently with those bones, then you will end up with a fillet just like that. And just so. And that's your bass fillet, it's done.
Perfect.
We're going to do a haddock. So, going into the belly cavity with my three fingers, I'm going to hold the fin back out the way, put your knife in through, just to cut that down. And again, up into the head, and then coming around here, you don't want to be losing this meat. There's meat here that you can eat. And again, it's just a case of running your knife in along the fins, into the back, down to the backbone, and straight up into the head. Now, I then push my thumb into the fish to release and open up the fillet. I then guide my knife through, again, straight down over the tail, releasing that fish, and then straight back up, across the top of the belly cavity, belly rib cage, straight down.
And again, there you aren't pulling it, you're just kind of leading it across.
I'm just literally, this is just being held out the way so I can see where I'm going with the knife. I want to be gentle, I don't want to be losing flesh. At the end of the day, you've caught a nice fish, there's plenty of meat on it for you to eat. And that's your haddock fillet.
Amazing.
Going up into the head, down. straight through, straight out. Release. This little bit here, I will say, will make things easier for you. If once you've got to this point and the fillet's there and it's still connected here, if you stick your, put the knife sort of half an inch through the belly to the rib cage and just nick it away, that releases it and it makes things so much easier to then come down across the belly straight out like that. Just trim away the, trim away those bones. Moving on, we've got John Dory, a fish that I know you're familiar with. Fantastic, lovely eating fish, and the meat from them is, oh, it's delicious. So, two ways that I would recommend preparing them, filleted or whole on the bone. Now, whole on the bone, you don't really want all this head and all these spiky fins, which are gonna hurt you, and they do hurt you when you get them in your finger.
Just to show you, if anybody isn't aware of these, if you ever do see them on the market, they have got a row.
Very tiny needle fins all the way along, all the way down. These are all spikes. They are just one nasty fish. Even under here, there's some nice, real sharp little sort of tiny.
They're almost like teeth,
needles,
aren't they?
Yeah. But whole, this is my way that I would recommend preparing and cooking. If you caught one, this way of preparing is very, very good. So we're gonna go up, we're gonna cut. These ones are already gutted. I'm gonna go down through the vertebrae, come down, and around here you've got some armor plated fins and bits of tough stuff which your knife won't go through. But that's,
you can see there, it might look like it's cut an awful lot of meat away, but it's not. It's a millimeter thick and the rest of it is
nothing there.
Just hard.
Yeah. So keep the head, good for making fish stock. So take your John Dory and you're gonna,
that's just a normal pair of strong scissors.
This is a normal pair of strong scissors. One pair unfortunately is better than the other. And once you've cut the tail off, come in here with your scissors and get, come the flesh side of the row of spikes, which if you can see that there, and then you're going to just go up. With a pair of scissors, and all that is removed. All those nasty spikes.
It is almost like a little mohawk, isn't it?
Yeah, that we've just talked about are removed. There's no point in cooking them because you're not going to eat them. So you may as well have them removed. Again, there's more nastiness. And there is a finished John Dory ready for putting in the oven.
Perfect.
So we've just done the whole John Dory, now we're just going to fillet a John Dory. Again, the main thing to be aware of if you're filleting this yourself is these spikes. I can't emphasise that enough because they will hurt you. So we're going to go in, up here, into the, around the back of the head, and then similar to a kind of flatfish but backwards, I think, we're going to score.
You've just gone in there, just behind that row of spikes, haven't you?
Just literally, the spike, the fin is there, the spikes are there, and I'm cutting in here along here. And I am gonna score all the way along there up into the head, from the tail. You don't be afraid, because you will not push your knife any further. You won't push it through the bones, they are rock hard. So you're just literally scoring that fish to make your life easier. Once you've done that, you're gonna take the knife and at a slight angle, you'll feel the actual bone of the fish coming away from the vertebrae, and you're gonna come along flat.
This will be where that flexible blade helps as well.
Flexible blade here is where you'll be literally coming along and you're coming along up into the head. And then once I get to the head and I've released here, I come back down, I turn around, and I go back down, I come out the tail. And again, similar with the bass that we did earlier, you're gonna come along over the, through the belly, out the other side. and I'm coming up here before you hit those.
So you've come along the back, and then as you get to the spikes, you kind of flicked up.
I've flicked my knife up. So I'm coming through and coming up like that to come away from these spikes here. So you come along, up, release the fillet, and there's your fillet.
Mentioning
lovely
about
bit of row in that one.
Mentioning about the worms that you get into fish.
Yep. So here we got worms, plenty of them as well. Lots of little small ones. This is the row. All these here are very small worms. Now, what we do in the fish shop is that we will literally shave that belly sinew away and tidy up the fillet. And there's your fillet ready for pan frying or cooking, however you see fit. Afraid to ask. Please don't be afraid to ask for the frames of your whitefish, whether it be a flatfish, a John Dory, a cod, anything. We have plenty of bones here and we're always willing to give them to you, the customer, or anyone to make fish stock from, which is a very simple process, and it's something that incorporated in your own cooking is fantastic, and it's a way of using all the product that you've purchased from the fish shop.
That's white fish, not oily fish.
Never use an oily fish, no. Recommended would be turbot head, turbot frames, brill, lemon sole, John Dory. If we had white fish heads like hake, haddock, cod, the bones from them as well would be, you know, just as good. Everything, anything like that to make stock, would be good to make stock from. Few things we wouldn't use would be mackerel, megrim soles, anything oily really. Whiting, they don't tend to make good stock, but you know, your prime fish like your turbots, your brill, your John Dory, they all make fantastic stock.
Well, I hope that's been interesting for you. I've definitely learned quite a few things. Thank you very much to Rich for walking us through what was a fantastic masterclass in filleting fish. Now some of this here, we're going to be taking it home and we're going to be cooking some of it fresh, but we are going to be freezing some of it down to cook later on. Now, have you got any advice you could give to me about freezing fresh fish like this?
Well, I always recommend, and we advocate here at Seabourne Fish, that you buy little and often, and come and see us and buy the freshest fish you can and not freeze it. But obviously that's not necessarily the case for some people. Some people like to buy a few bits to freeze it. One thing I would always recommend is that you wrap it well. So wrap it in cling film and then put it into another bag so that it doesn't get freezer burnt.
So like if lads have been on a wrecking trip and they've got a load of pollock or a load of ling, they're all right as long as they pack it tight.
Just fillet it and then wrap it up in cling film and then put those cling film fillets separately into a nice bag. And then again, tie the knot in that. What you're trying to alleviate is any moisture getting in there, which will then cause freezer burn, and you're also keeping the fish as pristine as you can.
Brilliant.
Thanks, John.